Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Black Diamond by Martin Walker, narrated by Robert Ian Mackenzie.
Chapter 1. There were not many times that Bruno CourrEges disliked his job, but today was certainly one of them. The weather wasn't to blame. A crisp day in late November with thin, high clouds trailing feebly across a sky that was determined to be blue. And even this early in the morning the sun was warm on his face and lending a rich gold to the few remaining leaves on the line of old oaks that fringed the town's rugby field. It gave warmth to the aged stone of the mairie across the river and to the red tile roofs of the houses that climbed the hillside. The season was still mild enough, he noticed, for the women to have thrown open their windows and the blue wooden shutters. Splashes of white and blue, stripes and floral patterns, adorned the townscape where they'd heaped out bedding to air on the balconies, as their mothers and grandmothers had done before them. It might be the last day of the year that would be possible. A touch of frost had silvered the grass outside his cottage when Bruno walked his dog just after dawn that morning, and he'd heard the first of the Christmas muzak in the supermarket over the weekend. Bruno turned back to the scene before him, the small crowd waiting outside the silent sawmill, its chimney no longer sending plumes of smoke into the clear sky. The forklift trucks that usually scurried like beetles around the warehouses under their loads of timber were all parked neatly in their garage. The air still carried the wholesome scent of fresh-cut wood. But the memory would soon fade, since this was the day that the sawmill, one of the biggest and oldest employers in Saint-Denis, was to close its doors. Bruno himself, acting under orders, had 2 weeks earlier delivered the formal notice of closure from the prefecture, citing the legal judgment against Siripon and its owner for breach of the new rules on pollution in urban areas. As the town's only policeman, Bruno had tied a copy of the order, wrapped in plastic against the weather, to the sawmill gates. Now he had to stand watch as the law took its solemn course and the court ruling was carried out. And of course he was obliged to deal with whatever ill feeling followed from this long-running feud between the jubilant Green Party and the man they called the arch-polluter of Saint-Denis. "Pont out! Pont out!" chanted the crowd, led into a chorus by a handsome man with a bullhorn, an expensive leather jacket, and a white silk scarf. His long blonde hair was tucked into a neat ponytail, and he wore a large Green Party button on his lapel. The posters the crowd carried explained the closure. There'd been no economic calamity, no financial embarrassment, no sudden shortage of timber that the woods and forests of the Dordogne region had produced for centuries. There was no shortage of demand for the oak and chestnut, pine and hemlock. Indeed, it was known that Boniface Pont, the owner of the sawmill that had been in his family for generations, was simply shifting his entire enterprise to another commune with wide forests and fewer than 200 voters, where he'd been assured there would be none of the angry demonstrations and the endless lawsuits that had driven him from Saint-Denis. "At last our children can breathe," read one of the posters, which made Bruno roll his eyes at the exaggeration. He'd played countless hours of rugby on the nearby playing field and endured dozens of training sessions while the chimney still spouted and never felt out of breath. "Environment 1, Pont 0," read another poster, which for Bruno was closer to the truth. Pont's sawmill had, over the decade of Bruno's time as the town's policeman, installed two separate sets of scrubbing equipment for the steam and smoke that belched from the tall chimney. Each installation was supposed to be the latest in clean air technology, yet within a few years each had been overtaken by new pollution directives from the European Union in Brussels. The most recent directive, which required any business with a polluting chimney to be a minimum distance from the nearest housing, had been the final straw for Boniface Pont. It wasn't his fault, Dupont maintained that the commune of Saint-Denis had decided, years before the latest directive had been thought of, to erect a block of cheap flats for public housing just 150 feet from the fence around his sawmill. But with a new regulation, that meant his business was 25 feet inside the limit required by the EU. "I've had enough of this green crap," Pont had announced at the last heated council meeting. "If you don't want the jobs I bring and the 200,000 euros I pay in taxes to this town's budget every year, then fine, I'll go where my jobs are wanted." Bruno had hoped to avoid trouble this morning, wishing that Pont would leave his building, lock his gates, and make a dignified departure while the crowd of Ecolo, the town's environmental activists, calmly relished their victory. But from the gossip in the cafes and the grumbling around the market stalls, he'd known that the closure might not go so smoothly. He had discussed with the mayor, Gérard Mangin, whether they should call on the gendarmes for reinforcements. But the moment they envisaged Capitaine Duroc blundering his way in, they had dropped the idea. Had Duroc been away on a course and the gendarmes under the experienced command of Sergeant Jules, their presence might have been a sensible precaution. As it was, the mayor and Bruno knew they could count only on themselves and on the years of trust they'd built with their neighbours. The crowd was bigger than Bruno had expected, swollen by curiosity and perhaps also by a sense that an era was passing and that history was finally overtaking the timber industry that had sustained Saint-Denis for centuries. Through wars and revolution, through boom times and recessions, the trees had always provided wine barrels and the boats that carried them, beams and floorboards and furniture for half the homes of France, desks in the schoolrooms and fires in the grates. Walnut trees provided oil and food and the young green fruit that produced the local vin de noix. Within living memory, in the hard times of Vichy and the German occupation, chestnut trees had even provided flour to make a kind of bread. So the closure of a sawmill was much more than simply a matter of jobs for the people of Saint-Denis, Bruno reflected, as he watched knots of pensioners shuffle up the road from the retirement home. The oldest, Rosalie Prarial, the last inhabitant of the town who claimed to remember seeing young men going off to the final battles of the Grande Guerre in 1918, was being helped along by Father Santoux. Like many of the other pensioners, Rosalie had worked at the sawmill all her life, starting under Boniface's grandfather. Montsouris, the town's only communist councillor, must have taken the day off from his job as a train driver, for he and his even more radical wife were approaching, followed by a delegation from the town's Chamber of Commerce. Bruno raised his eyebrows. It was a rare event that brought the left and the town's small businessmen together in common cause. Half the town appeared to be gathering for the event, and Bruno suspected that most of them would be unhappy at this triumph of the Greens. But he knew his townsfolk to be on the whole level-headed and law-abiding, and while any such assembly brought the prospect of trouble, they were not lined up in opposition, but gathered in separate knots and groups. A bit like a funeral, thought Bruno, when people hung back on the outskirts in deference to the family. The mayor stood under the trees that guarded the rugby field, deliberately keeping his distance from the crowd and the sawmill gates. Beside him stood the baron, the main landowner in the district, who was also Bruno's tennis partner. Albert, the chief of the town's fire brigade, was out of his customary uniform and smoking a pipe. A pickup truck lumbered around the corner from the public housing block, and Lespinasse, the local garage owner, clambered out with his sister from the florist's shop and his cousin from the tabac. They all shook hands with the mayor and his party and waved at Bruno. Then the unmistakable clatter of an elderly Citroën de Chevaux signalled the arrival of Pamela, the woman with whom Bruno was sometimes privileged to spend his nights. Few people now called her the mad Englishwoman as they had at first, at least in Bruno's hearing. Indeed, now that residents from other European countries had been given the right to vote in France's local elections, the mayor had talked of running her for a council seat at the next election. The mayor hoped to secure the foreigners' votes, but it was a sign that Pamela was accepted as a daughter of Saint-Denis. Despite his pleasure at seeing her and the bright smile she beamed at him, Bruno bit back a surge of irritation at Pamela's arrival. It was less that her presence would be a distraction and more that he felt self-conscious at playing his public role under her gaze. Usually he rather enjoyed Pamela's teasing and the slightly mocking attitude the British seemed to adopt towards their police, but he was beginning to feel nervous about the way the crowd was building. He sized up the situation. Other than scattered knots of spectators, the crowd was splitting into two camps. Opposite the main gates of the sawmill were the écolos, and at the front of the crowd that flanked them were young women with carriages and strollers. Some of them Bruno knew well, the wives and infants of the men who worked at the sawmill, men who now faced unemployment until Pont's new plant was ready. The women, glaring at the chanting écolos, had gathered by the small side gate their husbands used. Touching the peak of his cap, Bruno strolled across to greet them and to tousle the hair of the toddlers. He'd danced with the mothers at the Feast of Saint-Jean and taught the younger ones to play tennis. He'd attended their weddings and the baptisms of their children, hunted and played rugby with their fathers. "A sad day," he said to Axel as her twin daughters peeked out at Bruno from behind her skirts. "Bloody écolo, always putting their noses into other people's business," she snapped. "How come the law doesn't look after people like us for a change?" "Emile will be back at work soon," Bruno said, hoping to sound reassuring. "And I hear you got a job at the infant school. I suppose Emile's mother can look after the kids." "Lucky for some," sniffed another of the mothers. "There's no job for me, and whatever Pierre gets today will be the last money we see for a while. It's going to be a pretty thin Christmas." "I hope you're satisfied, you bastards," Axel shouted at the écolo. "Our kids will be going hungry because you keep whining over a whiff of smoke." "Pont out, pont out," the greens chanted back, led by the dashing man with the bullhorn. To Bruno, he was the strangest feature of this drama, a long-lost son of Saint-Denis, home from his years of travel with a brand-new Porsche convertible, enough money to buy an old farm and convert it into a restaurant, and exotic tales of life in Hong Kong, Bangkok, and Singapore. And he'd returned with an evident interest in local politics, a passionate commitment to the Green cause, and an eagerness to fund the lawsuit that had finally succeeded in winning an order for the closure of his father's sawmill. For the young man was Guillaume Pont, who insisted that everyone should call him Bill, and seemed intent on pursuing his family feud against his estranged father by any available means. Bruno wandered back to the crowd of chanting écolo and tapped Guillaume's shoulder. "Do you think you could stop the chanting for a while? The women over there worried about their men losing their jobs, and they're getting upset. It won't help if you rub their noses in it." "I know it's not their fault, but it's not ours either," Guillaume said pleasantly. As he put down the bullhorn to answer Bruno, the chanting died away. "We just want clean air, and we could create clean jobs as well if we put our minds to it." Bruno nodded and thanked him for the pause in the chanting. "Let's keep this calm and dignified. It's a sad day for some, and we don't want tempers raised when the men come out." "Perhaps the mairie should have thought of that when this campaign began, instead of using our tax money to subsidize the sawmill," Guillaume countered. "We can all be wise after the fact," Bruno said. The last time Pont had threatened to close his sawmill, Bruno and the mayor had managed to scrape up some funds from the town's budget to help pay for the scrubbing equipment. It had gained them 4 years until the new directive came in. The sawmill's 4 extra years of taxes had more than repaid the modest subsidy. Right now, I'm just concerned that we don't have an angry shouting match, Bruno added. You're the one with the bullhorn, so I'm holding you responsible. Don't worry, Guillaume replied with a smile that in other circumstances Bruno might have found charming. He put a hand on Bruno's arm. I can also use the bullhorn to calm them down. They'll listen to me. Let's hope so, monsieur. Bruno moved on to greet Alphonse, the elderly hippie from the commune in the hills above the town, and the first green to have been elected to the town's council. Can I count on you to keep things calm when the men come out, Alphonse? Bruno asked, shaking the hand of the man who made the best goat cheese in the district. We don't want trouble, Bruno, said Alphonse, a hand-rolled cigarette bouncing on his lower lip. We've won this battle. I don't know some of these people you've gathered here, Bruno said, surveying the crowd behind Guillaume and Alphonse. It's mostly the usual green campaigners from Périgueux and Bergerac, plus a couple all the way from Bordeaux. It's been a big campaign for us in this region. Don't worry, Bruno. It's just that we haven't had too many successes lately, and this one's important. There was a sudden alertness in the crowd, and Bruno turned to see the door of the sawmill office open. The employees, or rather the ex-employees, filed slowly out. The first ones paused as they saw the crowd at the gate, and a couple began to wave when they spotted their wives and children. Bruno walked across to the small side gate and gestured to the men to use it, thinking the sooner the men mingled with their families, the less chance there would be of a scene. But Marcel, the foreman, shook his head and advanced to the main entrance, where he unlocked the padlock and began to slide open the big iron gate. It's the last day, Bruno. We leave by the main gate, Marcel said. We didn't start this damn mess, and we aren't slinking out by the side door. He moved on to embrace his wife and then turned, his hands on his hips, to stare grimly at the écolo. Bruno moved to block Marcel's view and solemnly shook hands with each of the workers as they left the premises, murmuring briefly to them by name and suggesting it was time to go home with their families. Most of them shrugged and moved on to the waiting women and children. The mayor appeared at Bruno's side, following his example and shaking hands, and taking by the arm two of the younger men who were looking aggressively at the écolo to steer them gently away from any confrontation. It seemed to be working, the mood more mournful than angry, some of the married men taking children in their arms and starting to drift away. Then the main door of the showroom opened and Pont himself appeared, straight-backed and powerful despite his 70 years. His heavy shoulders bulged in his jacket, reminding Bruno that Pont had, in his youth, captained the town's rugby team. He still served on the club's board. He looked every inch the prosperous businessman in his suit, white shirt and bow tie, his bald head shining in the winter sun. Pont nodded courteously as two women who worked in the office left the building quickly and scurried away through the side gate. He locked the door of the business he'd inherited and expanded, and then turned to gaze impassively at the crowd. "Pont out! Pont out!" came the first, almost hesitant chant from the écolo, not amplified with any bullhorn. Bruno saw that Pont's son was gazing silently back at his father, their poses almost identical. But the bullhorn was by his side, and Guillaume didn't move as the greens behind him began a chorus of boos and jeers at the solitary businessman. Bruno walked quickly through the gate towards Pont Senior and spoke to him as a friend of many a rugby club dinner, rather than as the chief of police of Saint-Denis. "Your car is parked around the side, mon vieux. I'd strongly advise you to get into it and leave now before we have trouble. There are women and kids here."
Don't tell me what to do, Bruno. Not on my own property, Pon said quietly, not bothering to shift his gaze from the crowd at his gate. I didn't start this bordel de merde, but I'm walking out with my head high.
I'm going to have to walk with you then, Bruno said.
Suit yourself.
Pon began striding toward the gate. The boos increased in volume, and some of the écolo began a surge forward, only to be restrained by Pon's son, who stretched out his arms to hold them back. There was a cold smile on his face as his father approached him. Too fast for Bruno to intervene, the older man didn't even break stride as he slapped his son across the cheek, so hard that Guillaume staggered and fell to one knee, dropping his bullhorn. Pon stalked on into the crowd of his workers, not looking back and not pausing, as some of his employees cheered and slapped him on the shoulders. White-faced except for the flaming red patch on his cheek, Guillaume shook his head and rose quickly, fury in his eye, surging forward after his father. Bruno wrapped his arms around the man to hold him back as Guillaume shouted, "You bastard! You dirty bastard!" Bruno felt hands wrenching at his arms, then someone was hauling him back by the neck as Guillaume's écolos came to free their leader. Goaded into action, two of the younger workers from the sawmill piled in alongside Bruno, followed by a shrieking Axel, who waded into the fray, raked her nails down Guillaume's face, and pulled on the lapels of his jacket to butt him hard in the face. She pushed him back, spitting in his eye as blood began to spout from his battered nose. Bruno rammed an elbow into the man, wrenching his neck, and kicked back hard to free himself. He turned, picked up Axel by the waist, and thrust her back behind him, luckily into the path of Montsouris, who was steaming into the brawl with Marcel and a couple of the younger workers. Then the mayor and the baron were at each side of him, their arms in the air, advancing to make a gap between the two crowds and calling for calm. Bruno held up his hand to restrain Montsouris, and suddenly he heard the cawing of the rooks from the oak trees as a silence fell, and all the angry energy seemed to leak away. Everyone seemed chastened by the eruption of violence and the sight of blood. Axel was sobbing quietly as Father Santou led her back to Emile, who was kneeling as he held his dumbstruck children. The priest helped Bruno steer the townspeople back along the fence to the road that led to the town.
"I'll see the old ones back," said Father Santou. "That was a very sad moment, the son and the father."
"Whatever happened to the Pont family, it was all before my time. Do you remember any of it?" Bruno asked.
"There was a very ugly separation when the boy was 12 or so, and he left for Paris with his mother. I think they got divorced in the end. I heard she died in Paris. It must be 15 or 20 years back."
Bruno nodded as Father Santou gave his arm to two elderly women. Old Pon himself was helping Rosalie. The mayor would know the background, thought Bruno, or perhaps the baron. Whatever the origins of the family feud, the return of the son meant that it could become Bruno's problem. He turned back toward the sawmill and paused to take in the arresting tableau. But for the chimney and the buildings of the sawmill, the scene reminded him of one of the religious paintings in the Church of Saint-Denis. Guillaume Pon lay on his back, his head on Pamela's lap and blood all down his shirt, while Fabiola, the young doctor from the Saint-Denis Medical Centre, tended to his battered face. The mayor and the baron stood solemnly at each side of them, and Albert was kneeling at Pon's feet. Around them stood the silent écolo, looking down at the son felled by his father. Bruno remembered precisely the last time he'd studied the painting. He'd been sitting near it during the Easter choral concert in the church, when Father Santou had spent weeks rehearsing the choir for the performance of Haydn's 7 Last Words of Our Saviour on the Cross. Bruno had remembered studying the photocopied text of the work and Father Santou's short commentary. One of the phrases had stayed with him and emerged again now, unbidden, into his head. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Father, Father, why hast thou forsaken me? Chapter 2. Bruno loved to drive in the Baron's old Citroën DS, a car that had been built before he was born. He enjoyed the way the car hardly leaned when cornering and how it still looked like the most modern car ever made. Bruno had heard the Baron sing its virtues a score of times. That it had been the world's first car with disc brakes and hydraulic suspension and some other features he could never quite remember. But one thing the Baron had ensured Bruno never forgot was that it had saved the life of the Baron's hero, Charles de Gaulle, whom he always called Le Général rather than President. During one of the several assassination attempts in the 1960s by the OAS, the military and colonialist rebels who wanted to keep Algeria French, the car's tires had been shot out, yet it could still drive away at full speed. Every time the Baron's dais came in for service, Lespinasse at the garage would almost purr with pleasure.
"Did you know I bought this car from Pont?" the Baron asked, his eyes on the narrow road ahead, dense trees on either side flickering past in the glow of the headlights. It was still an hour before dawn, but they had wanted to be at the Saint-Albert market before it officially opened at 8 a.m.
"It must be over 20 years ago, maybe more, not long after his wife left him. I got it cheap. These days they can go for over 100,000 at classic car auctions."
"You'll never sell this," Bruno said. "It's part of you. But I wanted to ask you about Pont. How come the wife left?"
"I'm told he used to beat her. She came from the south, near Carcassonne. Got a job teaching at the college here. A real beauty. Blonde hair, but with that lovely golden skin you sometimes get in the Midi. I was living in Paris then, and Pont had already grabbed her when I came down one summer. Olivia, her name was."
"Jealous?"
"I certainly was." The Baron laughed. "But then things changed. Pont was never known for fidelity. She put up with it for a while, then she started taking her revenge. I was one of the lucky ones. Not the only one, though. When Pont found out, that was the end of the marriage."
"How was she doing, financially?"
"I helped her get a lawyer. She did okay. Pont was never mean about money, at least not where the boy was concerned. But I know he complained the boy never wanted to see him, that Olivia had poisoned the kid's mind about him."
"Did the boy know about you?"
"I doubt it. I'm pretty sure Pont never knew about me either. We were always discreet. I was married by the time she came to Paris."
"Why the delay before she got a divorce?"
The Baron shrugged.
"Divorce wasn't so easy in those days, not with a kid, and even trickier after she took the boy to Paris. Pont claimed she'd abandoned the family home, but the lawyer got her a decent settlement."
"What happened then?"
"She taught for a while. Later she got a management job in a good hotel by the Opera, and then opened her own restaurant. I helped her a bit, but it was never a great success. Then she got breast cancer and everything fell apart. The boy went off backpacking around Asia, didn't even make it back for the funeral. It was just me, some other old boyfriends, and the staff from her restaurant. Pont didn't come. At least he sent a wreath."
They had arrived just a few minutes before 7. Bruno climbed out of the car's warm interior and shivered as he pulled on his old army greatcoat. He looked up to see if he could discern the first hint of lightness in the eastern sky. Not dawn yet, he thought, and pulled his small basket from the back seat. It was a modest haul he had to offer, and he only had the second grade of truffle, the Brumale. The real black diamond, the Milano Sporum, would not be traded until later in December. The best of them, ones that could go for more than 1,000 euros a kilo seldom came onto the market until January. Bruno had planted the alley of white oaks that would nourish the growth of truffles on his land soon after his arrival in Saint-Denis, knowing that it would be a few years more before he would have the chance of a real harvest. But he had 6 small and knobbly brumales of different shapes and sizes, 3 from his own trees and 3 from his forays in the woods behind his home. They weighed in total something less than 0.5 pound. The largest was just a little bigger than a golf ball. He might, with luck, get 100 euros for them, but the price would depend on the market. He dipped his nose into the basket to smell the deep, earthy scent. He wrapped the truffles inside a page of Sud-Ouest and stuffed it into his pocket. They smelled better when they were kept warm. He'd left the 2 best of his brumale at home, steeping in virgin olive oil. They would be for his own use. Normally, he wouldn't bother to attend the market until late December, even with his brumale, but the Baron had said Hercule wanted to see him, and Bruno owed Hercule a great deal. When Bruno had first seen the tiny darting fly beneath one of his trees that signalled the presence of truffles, he'd begun to think about investing for the future. The Baron had introduced him to one of his old army friends from the Algerian War, Hercule Vendreau, who lived near Saint-Albert, the town that was to truffles what Chateau Petrus was to wine lovers. Hercule had visited Bruno's property, lunched well, given his advice on what trees to plant and where, and returned every year since to enjoy a meal and to stir up the leaves under Bruno's young oaks to see if the flies might be dancing. The 2 men had exchanged war stories, admired each other's dogs, and become friends. At first, they made a point of hunting and then dining together at least 2x a year, once on Bruno's land and again on Hercule's. Their meetings had steadily become more frequent, lubricated by the fine wines on which Hercule spent the money he made from his truffles. 3 years ago, Hercule had pointed out the first sign of terre brûlée around Bruno's sapling oaks, the ring of dark earth that seemed to have been scorched. Bruno had his truffles and had made 200 euros in his first year, but fewer than 100 in the second. He was hoping for much more this year, and a steady future income that would never come to the attention of the taxman. The formal market started when the doors opened to the modern glass-walled building that the city fathers had constructed beside the churchyard. Now they even had an online market, but Hercule had taught Bruno that the real business was transacted before the market opened. And much of the trade was done outside the building, as it always had been. Men in ancient overcoats with patient dogs at their heels, discreetly slipping from their pockets small handfuls of truffles wrapped in newspaper. Some were standing there already, each of them solitary, glancing almost furtively at his neighbours along the street, wondering what treasures the rivals might bring. They looked, to Bruno's professional eye, deeply suspicious, like a collection of voyeurs trying to summon the courage to spy through bathroom windows. It made the prospect of joining their ranks unappealing. He planned to sell his own truffles in the town market. The Baron led the way up the steps onto a small terrace and into the café opposite the church. The windows were steamed up, and as he opened the door, a rush of noise came from inside, where 30 or 40 men and their dogs crowded into a space designed for half that number. Désirée, the only woman in the room, was serving croissant and tartine, ringing up sales at a furious pace, while her husband manned the espresso machine. Hercule was taking his coffee at the corner of the bar and signalled to Désirée for 2 more when he saw them squeezing their way through to him. A big man, his back starting to stoop now that he was well into his 70s, Hercule had sharp blue eyes and a fringe of white hair under the beret he invariably wore. His thick white moustache was brown in the centre from the Gauloise he smoked. His elderly mongrel, Pompon, a legendary truffle hunter, craned his neck forward to sniff at Bruno's trousers, picking up the scent of his dog, Gigi. The three men shook hands and turned to the counter, where Désiré had placed three coffees, three croissants, and three large cognacs. Like the cognac at dawn when they went hunting, it was a ritual.
"Salut, Bruno. Show me what you've got."
He nodded when Bruno turned toward the bar. Sheltered by the Baron and Hercule, he took out his small parcel and opened it so that only Hercule could see. The beret dipped, and even over the noise in the café, Bruno heard him sniff.
"Not bad for Brumal. Mine aren't ready yet, and prices always go up the nearer we get to Christmas. I know who'll want some of that. But let's finish our breakfast first."
He downed his cognac and ordered three more to tip into fresh cups of coffee. 30 minutes later, they were in the churchyard and talking to a renifleur, one of the scouts who bought on behalf of a group of Bordeaux restaurants. The scout pulled out a small scale, and Bruno was pleased to receive 6 20-euro notes in return. He offered one of them to Hercule as commission, but he waved the money away.
"I asked you here," he said. "We need to talk. But I'll take a look in the market first, just to show our faces."
A small knot of men was gathered at the door. Bruno recognized his counterpart in Saint-Albert, the town policeman, Nico. Bruno shook hands with him, a much older man, close to retirement, saying he was off duty and just there for the market. Nico introduced him and the Baron to the town's mayor, a live wire who'd pushed for the online truffle market and had gotten European funding to turn Saint-Albert into a pilot project for alternative energy. Just before 8 a.m., a plump man appeared with a key in his hand, almost breaking into a trot when he saw the mayor. It was Didier, the market manager, an ingratiating grin on his face, scurrying to unlock the door into the large room with a series of tables covered in white cloth. A gleaming digital scale held pride of place beside the new computer that ran the online market. Three webcams covered the room, and on a side table in the corner stood a high-grade microscope to help settle disputes about the grading of the various truffles. Bruno understood enough of the technicalities to know that some unscrupulous dealers tried to pass off a châtain as a Brumal.
"It's a joke," Hercule murmured in Bruno's ear. "All the real deals are still done outside, between people who've known each other for years and don't need fancy machines to know what's what. You'll see the renifleur didn't even bother to come inside. There'll be another auction at the end of the day for the stocks left over, but there's something fishy about that."
Hercule prowled around the tables where the sellers were laying out their wares in small baskets. He bent to sniff a couple of times, but moved on. A third time he bent, and then turned to Bruno.
"Sniff this one. It's good. Maybe even a bit better than yours."
He turned his back on the vendor to whisper into Bruno's ear.
"He's asking 50 euros 100 grams. You did better, and you didn't have to pay the market fee."
Hercule plucked Bruno's sleeve and jerked his head at the Baron to lead them outside. They walked up the hill, past the tower of the ruined castle, its stone improbably pale in colour after enthusiastic cleaning, and its surroundings of fresh turf looking too picturesque to be true. Hercule's dog paused to lift a back leg on the base of the ruin, and the old man led them at a brisk and warming pace up the lane to his home. Each time he visited Hercule's house, Bruno was curious that such an evidently learned and cultivated man should affect the style and dress of a country hayseed. The walls were filled with books. From the way they were stuffed sideways onto crammed shelves, with small note cards and bookmarks in the pages, it was clear they were constantly being used. In the spaces between bookshelves were paintings and hangings with foreign calligraphies. Bruno could not have identified, far less read them, had Ecule not explained the difference between the Viet, the Khmer, the Thai, the Lao, and the Mandarin. The furniture was old and heavy and comfortable, of a dark, dense wood and style that Bruno now knew to be Vietnamese. A vast desk squatted by the window, covered by newspaper clippings, a laptop computer, and framed photographs of an Asian woman and child, plus several of French soldiers in uniforms of an earlier era. The Baron moved to the desk and picked up one of the photos, turning it to the light.
Babel Wed, when they still loved the French army. I recognize that corner by the Saint-Eugène Cemetery, the Baron said as Bruno looked over his shoulder. That's General Massu himself on the right, so it must be 57 when he was running the Battle of Algiers. I didn't know you knew Massu that well, Ecule.
He put it down and looked at his old friend.
You had something on your mind. Tell us.
I don't know if you can do anything to help, but I've got to get this off my chest.
He knelt to put a match to the nest of newspapers beneath the kindling in the fireplace, and then stood, watching the fire catch hold.
A drink? Coffee?
They shook their heads.
It's the market. There's something nasty going on, and they won't listen to me. When they think of fraud, they think only of the old tricks like people dyeing the white summer truffles and selling them as blacks. But this is different. One of the renifleurs, not the one you met, says a couple of his big clients in Paris claim they've been fobbed off with fakes. Cheap sinensis, Chinese black truffles. It's common enough in oils and prepared foods, but each of them reckoned they got some Chinese rubbish in a shipment of tailings. That's the small and crumbled stuff they use for truffle oil and stews.
No official complaints yet? Asked Bruno.
The big hotels hate to do it because it could hurt their reputation. These are places where they'll pay 1,000, 1,500 euros for a good Perigord black. But if they feel cheated, they just won't buy any more.
You said nobody will listen to you. Who did you tell? Asked Bruno.
Didier, the market manager. When he said I was crazy, I went to the mayor. But he's invested a lot of money in the market and new equipment designed to make sure this kind of thing doesn't happen. He gave me the brush off. And Nico is so close to retirement he didn't want to know. So I thought of you, Bruno. You know truffles. You know what they mean to this part of the world.
How do these Chinese truffles get here?
Straight from the 13th arrondissement in Paris, down around Place d'Italie. It's the biggest Chinatown in Europe. The truffles come in from China, and we're the next stop. There's a lot of money to be made, but it's going to ruin Saint-Albert. Look, I'll show you what I mean.
Ecule went to his kitchen and came back with a tray. It held a cheese board with a quarter of what looked like brie de meaux, some slices from a baguette and three small bottles, each filled with oil covering a layer of small black lumps.
I want you to try this, Ecule said, putting down the tray as a rich, almost gamey scent reached Bruno's nostrils. A couple of days ago, I sliced this brie in half horizontally and slipped three slices of truffles between the halves. I just took them out, but the perfume will be wonderful.
He smeared thin wedges of brie onto three slices of bread and handed one each to Bruno and the Baron.
Glorious, said Bruno.
The rich and succulent cheese had suddenly developed whole new depths and layers of taste, as if... Bruno tried to think of a way to put it. and then he thought that it tasted as if it had grown up and gone to university and won doctorates and become a professor and had a loving wife and handsome children and won a Nobel Prize and spent the money on expensive mistresses and vintage champagne.
"Smells like a poule de luxe,"
said the Baron, and Bruno wondered why truffles made men think of sex. It had the same effect on him. Ecule turned to the bottles on the tray.
"This first one is the real thing. Olive oil with one of my decent blacks from last year."
He held it out for them.
"Now try this. That's a Chinese black in the same oil. Can you tell the difference?"
Bruno could. There was a sour note to the odour, like poor soil baked into dust by the sun. And another flavour lingered behind it, almost like gasoline.
"Now, try this. That's what they're getting in Paris. It's mainly Chinese, with a bit of the real thing to add flavour."
This time Bruno smelled the real black Périgord first, but then the flavour seemed to die away. The sample had the same woodsy smell, but the vegetation had a touch of rankness.
"It starts off okay, but after a few moments my Brumal is better than that," he said.
"Big difference," the Baron nodded.
"Any idea who might be behind this?"
Ecule shrugged.
"It has to be one of the regulars, someone we know and trust. It takes a long time to accept strangers in the market."
"If the mayor decided to take you seriously, what could be done to stop this?" Bruno asked.
"Constant spot checks of everything that's shipped out. It's tough to fool the locals and the renifleurs. It's no coincidence that this has started to happen with the online market. People buy over the internet and it gets shipped in vacuum packs, but checking all the shipments would mean time, extra staff and money."
"And it wouldn't catch the bad guys," the Baron said thoughtfully.
"I think this is a lot bigger than it looks," Ecule went on. "It's not just the odd Chinese merchant pulling a fast one. Or, if it is, then it's like reconnaissance to see if they can expand this business and start making real money."
"How big is this?" Bruno asked. "Could organized crime be involved?"
"We harvested over 50 tons of truffles in France last year, and they went for between 700 and 1,500 a kilo. That's a 50 million euro business, enough to attract some big players. China bought more than 5 million euros worth of Périgord truffles. It's our fastest growing market. Just 3 years ago, they bought nothing. It's like cognac. Anything that's really rare and expensive has a snob appeal for China's new rich. So if you can add a few scraps of our good stuff and then sell cheap Chinese truffles as if they were from France, there's real money to be made at the Chinese end. But it won't last long before they get caught and the market collapses in scandal. And that means the end of our truffle business, just as it's about to take off."
"You mean with these new plantations I've heard about?" asked the Baron.
Ecule nodded.
100 years ago, we'd produce 700 tons a year here in France, mostly from plantations, as people learned to infect young trees with truffle spores. But the trade collapsed with the Great War. Truffles weren't just common in the old days, they were used in huge quantities. Did you ever hear of Escoffier's great recipe for his Salade Jockey Club? Composed of equal parts chicken, asparagus, and truffles. Nobody could afford to do that these days. But now the plantations are starting up again after that Spanish guy, Arrozarena, began producing 10 and 20 tons a year down in Navaleno.
I remember old Pond starting a plantation near here a few years back," the Baron said. "Then he got into that lawsuit over his sawmill, and he needed money fast. He cut down the trees for the timber and lost a fortune.
He must be doing better because he's started a new plantation, said Hercule. And he's not the only one. That's why the mayor launched the new market building. These new plantations can produce 100 kilos of truffles per acre, which makes a lot more money than the 400 euros you'll get from an acre of wheat. It's a growth industry for this region, unless it all gets ruined by these frauds.
What would happen if one of these Paris hotels made a formal complaint, or even a polite inquiry? Bruno asked.
That would certainly get the mayor's attention. If you're prepared to help me, it's worth trying him, even though he probably thinks I'm just an old fool.
I don't think any real Frenchman would dare think that, said the Baron, looking at the corner beside the desk where Hercule's Croix de Guerre hung, with his citation for the Légion d'honneur in pride of place above it.
I have a plan, said Hercule. I told our mayor that if he doesn't call in the police now, the least he needs is an outside security review. If this blows up, he has to be able to say he tried something. I suggested he ask for you, since you know truffles. You're independent, and you're a cop with no jurisdiction in Saint-Albert. You're qualified, friendly, independent, and deniable. That makes you perfect.
What you need is a complaint, even a letter of inquiry to the mayor from these big clients, something to force the issue, said Bruno. Call your renifleur, get that letter sent, and then suggest your mayor call mine and ask for me to be made available for a discreet inquiry, and I'll see what I can do.
The guy in trouble will be Didier, the market manager, said Hercule. I don't trust him an inch.
He seemed like a fussy type, said Bruno, recalling the scurrying figure, half-trotting to open the market building as the mayor stood impatiently waiting. How did this Chinese stuff get past him?
They're trying to do everything too fast with this internet market, said Hercule, and Didier's not that good. He used to run that truffle plantation that Pons set up. Didier only got that job because his wife was Pons' cousin. But when Pons had to sell the timber, Didier was out of work. Then they built the new market and he got the job. His sister's husband is related to the mayor's wife.
Bruno nodded. Family connections were the way it worked around here, probably the way it worked everywhere. And his own mayor would be eager to help, since the support of Saint-Albert would help him get elected to be the next chairman of the Conseil Régional.
Now, to more pleasant matters, said Hercule. It's my turn to host the hunting. When's your next day off?
Thursday.
I'd like some venison this winter, and the season's open. We've got some roe deer on the land and some of your favourite bicasse.
I'll have to join you late, maybe around 10. The mayor won't fork out for a new police van, so I'll have to take the old one into the garage for the contrôle technique.
Thursday at 10 it is. I'll go out early, take a look around. We can meet at the farthest shack, the one on the track that leads off the road to Pona.
I know the place, said Bruno. I'll bring a thermos of coffee.
And I'll bring the cognac, said the Baron.
One thing I wanted to ask you, Bruno said quickly. That place you mentioned, Bab el Oued, what was it?
It's a suburb of Algiers, where the Pieds Noirs used to live before we lost the war and they fled back to France. They were French settlers, the poorer ones, but they wanted Algeria to stay French. When de Gaulle decided to pull out, Bab el Oued became the heart of the OAS. But that photo was taken before then, when they still loved us, before de Gaulle decided that there was no choice but to grant Algeria its independence.
Like the rest of the army, I found some very welcoming girlfriends there, said the Baron. He was staring into the fire. He looked up. You were already married, Hercule. This was all before I was born, Bruno said, who read enough history to know the broad outlines of the Algerian War. Still, every time I ride in the Baron's Citroën, he tells me how the car saved de Gaulle's life when the OAS tried to assassinate him.
Organisation de l'Armée Secrète. Not only did they come close to killing de Gaulle, they came damn close to staging a military coup back in 61 with half the army on their side. They took over Algiers and people were panicking about parachute drops on Paris. De Gaulle ordered the Air Force to patrol the Mediterranean coast with orders to shoot down any transport planes heading north. The Baron was one of the few in his unit who didn't join the OAS.
Would you still be friends if he had?
Absolutely not, said Hercule. I'd probably have shot him.
Chapter 3 Pamela turned her deux chevaux into the gate and down the newly built road that led to the restaurant.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.